Part of the British strategy of geopolitics for the Asia-Pacific region has also involved the fomenting of a trade war between Japan and the United States. During a recent conference in Washington, D.C., Lyndon LaRouche was asked by a member of the audience to give his views on this matter, including LaRouche's estimate of why the Clinton administration was willing to go along with a gambit which in effect risked a very important strategic relationship over a few billion dollars worth of car parts. Here is what LaRouche had to say about the specter of a U.S.-Japanese trade war.
Well, you know, the president doesn't have too much money. And in the last campaign, and one might presume in the next one, 1996, that the president might rely upon the friends of Mickey Cantor to raise a lot of the money he requires for his election campaign. Thus, because of those kinds of considerations, in the United States dealing with Japan and with other situations, you must understand there's a dimension of adjustment of the periphery of policy which may not coincide with the actual thinking of the president or some other people in the United States government. That's the problem. The problem of this, which those of you in political life know, either from personal experience or from seeing people do it, is that people have two agendas. They have the one agenda, which is their commitment. And in order to be in position to attempt to realize what they have picked as their commitments, they will trade off. They'll trade off to people to support them. They'll trade off to keep their enemies off their back and that kind of thing. And that's what happens in this Japan thing. The problem in Japan is twofold. The crucial problem in Japan goes back to the 1970s, the modern form. It goes back to the time that the United States said, during the time of Kissinger and afterward, and Brzezinski under Carter, said to Japan, you cannot help Mexico, because we in the United States will not tolerate a new Japan developing below the Rio Grande border. That's what Brzezinski said to the government of Mexico shortly after becoming National Security Advisor. Then, remember the Shah of Iran. Why was Iran pulled down? Because the British government and people in the United States government would not tolerate what the Shah was doing. What was the Shah doing? The Shah did two things which infuriated the government of the United States, which was actually the number two government of Britain at that time. The Shah insisted that there was no oil shortage. Remember? Some of you were old enough to remember that. And the Shah said, Iran has enough oil to move everything, sitting in tankers on the seas, and you people in the United States and elsewhere will not admit these tankers. There is no oil shortage. There was no oil boycott. It was Henry Kissinger and his buddies in London, in the London Petroleum Marketing Cartel, rigged an oil price hoax as part of their effort of looting the world. And the Shah didn't go along with it. That got him in trouble. The second thing he did that got him in trouble, where the British agent Khomeini was deployed against him under directions from British intelligence, was that he was negotiating for oil for technology agreements with Japan and other places to turn Iran into a new Japan of Central Asia. And that they wouldn't tolerate. So they organized the revolution, the Khomeini revolution against the Shah, which was organized by London through people like the Rockefellers and others in the United States who organized that revolution under British direction. And I saw some of this personally in Paris, where Khomeini was sitting, making tapes together with British intelligence, which were broadcast over the BBC, giving out the instructions for the following day. That's what the problem is. And the Japan was told that it could not engage in building up new Japans in developing countries around the world. Japan's policy had been to build up developing nations such as Brazil, Iran, Mexico, and so forth, to develop the purchasing power of these countries with the idea that as countries became more wealthy as a result of capital improvements, that these countries would be able to import more things, and that Japan would export more capital goods to countries that were benefiting from their own technological progress. The United States said no. So they said to Japan, as in the, for example, the Mexico deal, Brzezinski said to the Japanese, Zbigniew Brzezinski, we call him crazy Zbigniew sometimes, we don't make the deal for Mexico oil. We will give you Alaska oil. And what you will do, instead of exporting to Mexico, you will export to the United States consumer markets. Now we say Japan has engaged in trade war against the United States. Why do they do that? Because the United States told them to do it. The British told them to do it in Europe. So Japan had a disoriented policy which was imposed upon it by the United States. Now, as a result of all this winging, in the past 4 years, the British influence has taken over in Japan. Whenever you see the name of the Ozawa faction in Japan, you're looking at the British. So we have layers of conflict with Japan which involve the British influence over the Ozawa faction, which is recently the dominant faction. This is the faction which destroyed the LDP under British instruction. All this faction in Japan is associated with the British. As a matter of fact, Japan is financing a section of British intelligence called the IISS, International Super Strategic Studies. This unit exemplifies loudly the intent of the British government to bring about the division of China into several parts following the death of Deng Xiaoping. This founding group in Japan is funding IISS. The United States policy now, under President Clinton, as under Roosevelt in the 1940s, is that China should be a unified and developing country and a bulwark of U.S. partnership for development of East Asia. And the British are playing the same game they played against the United States under Churchill back in the 1940s against the United States today. And one faction of Japan is actually working for the British on that. We have people on our side like Bush leaguers. One of the biggest members of organized crime in Japan, and this is fairly well publicly known, is Prescott Bush, the brother of George Bush, President George Bush, who is an intimate associate of Japan organized crime. He is the Meyer Lansky of Japan, so on. So it's a complicated situation. Our policy toward Japan is not really a just policy. But that's not the highest priority in this town, because the way politics works. The point is, I think the president's policy, and I don't speak for him, but what I see is the president's policy is concentrate on the main issues. Because if you win on the main issues, then you will have the power and position to begin to address, in new terms of reference, the secondary issues. And actually, the issue of Japan, the tariff issue with Japan, is a secondary issue. What's being built up is the British, however, and the brutish press in the United States, that's the British colony press, are playing up that this tariff issue between the United States and Japan is the big issue. It is not the big issue. It is important for Japan, but it is a secondary issue. The primary issue is the entire shebang. The world financial monetary system is collapsing, and that collapse is coming up fast. If we cannot address that, we cannot solve any other problems. So what I see the White House doing is essentially letting the Japan policy work its way out on the ordinary policy level and not addressing the hard issue at that point.
At the heart of the matter remains the question of British geopolitics. For the average American, the British monarchy and oligarchy have often appeared as a group of eccentric fuddy-duddies living in a shabby, rundown museum and obsessed with issues like Waterloo, the charge of the Light Brigade, and Lord Kitchener. This is the world of myth. Older Americans can still remember the traditional deadly hostility of the British oligarchy that gave us the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812 with the British burning of the White House and the Capitol, and the Civil War in which the British so openly sponsored the Confederate States of America. But then came the period of the US-UK special relationship, starting in some ways with Theodore Roosevelt, who wanted very much to be a member of what he thought was the Anglo-Saxon master race, to which he thought the British held the keys. Theodore Roosevelt was a pen pal of King Edward VII of Great Britain, who organized the encircling alliances that made World War I possible. Roosevelt told Edward that the interests of the American Republic and the British Empire were identical, a piece of raving insanity. Later, Woodrow Wilson brought the United States into World War I on the British side against strong internal opposition. Propaganda of the World War II period concentrated on Anglo-American unity and the Atlantic Charter and its four freedoms, even though Churchill later proclaimed that the four freedoms did not apply to the British Empire or even outside of Europe. When we dig deeper into the history of our century, we find that behind the facade of the US-UK special relationship, the old British hostility towards the American Republic has been at work. Because of the British desire to promote their own security in Europe and in the Atlantic, it is rather in Asia and in the Pacific that the British anti-American operations have often been conducted on the largest scale. Let us start right after World War I. The U.S. had just saved the British from defeat, or at least endless stalemate, in the war that Edward VII and his gang had organized against Germany. Was there any British gratitude? On the contrary, there was hostility that took London and Washington to the brink of war at least twice during the 1920s. The reasons lay in naval rivalry, especially in the Pacific. At the time of the Versailles Treaty, the main means of intercontinental power projection was the battle fleet, made up of battleships called dreadnoughts and super dreadnoughts. There were four leading naval powers. These were, in order of strength, Britain, Germany, the US, and Japan. After the war, the German high seas fleet was scuttled at Scapa Flow. That left Britain, the US, and Japan. Now remember the principle of geopolitics that Britain must ally with number three against number two. That meant a British-Japanese alliance against the US. Remember also that Britain and Japan were bound by a close alliance. Winston Churchill demanded in those days that the British should keep the world naval supremacy they had held since Trafalgar. The only real challenger was the United States, which had the capability of building far more battleships than the British could ever hope to match. At Versailles, Admiral Benson, the US Chief of Naval Operations, told the British that their insistence on maritime supremacy over the United States would lead to war. These issues came to a head during the presidency of Warren G. Harding of Ohio, who was elected in 1920. Harding supported a big US fleet. Between Harding's election and the inauguration, there was a war scare with reports that Britain and Japan were going to gang up on the US. A group of Anglophiles in Harding's cabinet, around Secretary of State Charles Evans Hughes, responded by calling the Washington Naval Conference the first great disarmament swindle of our century. Hughes proposed that the US would stop building 15 ultra-modern battleships if the British and Japanese would scrap some older ships and settle on a 5-to-5-to-3 ratio for British, US, and Japanese battleships. This cooled the crisis for a time, but the British were determined to get Harding. The destabilization of Harding bears an uncanny similarity to the British-directed Whitewatergate operations against President Clinton in our own time. British press conduits accused Harding of being a sleazy machine politician who had been picked by Republicans in a smoke-filled room at their convention. The same press portrayed Harding as a womanizer who kept mistresses and who joined his cronies for cards and bourbon in a little house on K Street. The Madison Guarantee scandal of those years was Teapot Dome, a naval oil reserve that was sold off to Sinclair Oil in exchange for bribes to Albert Fall, Harding's Secretary of the Interior. These doings had been brought into the public eye by Theodore Roosevelt, Jr., another Anglophile operative. Harding was preparing to run for re-election in 1924 when he took a trip west and made an excursion to Vancouver, British Columbia. He soon fell ill and never recovered. The Anglophile press claimed that Harding had been poisoned by his own wife. Today, we must place Harding on the same list with William Henry Harrison and Zachary Taylor, American presidents who died under mysterious circumstances, with British intelligence the prime suspect in each case. Harding was succeeded by Vice President Calvin Coolidge of the well-known Boston Brahmin family. Coolidge had an Anglophile profile, but under Coolidge, a new crisis emerged, this time around cruisers, and the U.S. and the British went to the brink of war again in 1927 and 1928. It was said that the taciturn Coolidge, known as Silent Cal, had never developed so much vehement passion about anything in his life. But then the presidency went to Herbert Hoover, the biggest Anglophile of the decade, and the cruiser issue was settled at the London Naval Conference. Now, the British had given up their own alliance with Japan in 1921 as part of that 5-5-3 deal. But U.S. intelligence was certain that there was a deal between London and Tokyo under the table. Veterans of World War II who fought in the Marshall Islands, the Carolines, and the Marianas may be surprised to learn that these were originally German islands that were taken by the Japanese during World War I. At Versailles, the British ignored U.S. protests and made sure that the Japanese kept these islands, which were astride the sea lanes for U.S. communication to Guam and the Philippines. This meant that U.S.-Japanese hostility was pre-programmed by the British at Versailles. As a result of naval disarmament, the British kept their own naval world supremacy until about 1943. Under this regime, in spite of the official ratios, Japan came very near to naval parity with the United States. It was this near parity in ships that allowed Japanese strategic planners to venture the gamble of Pearl Harbor as a calculated risk. Naval disarmament had left the United States with a hollow navy, too weak to support declared national policy. And in this way, British geopolitics paved the way for Pearl Harbor. The war danger with Britain during these years was so acute that American planners in the War and Navy departments developed a war plan for dealing with possible aggression by the British Empire, most likely in tandem with Japan. Under the color codes then in use, Britain was red, Japan was orange, and the U.S. blue. Canada was crimson, and Australia and New Zealand were scarlet. War Plan Red dealt with a possible war arising from British resort to violence against U.S. economic, commercial, and naval ascendancy. In case of war, blue's biggest priority was to prevent a buildup of red imperial power on crimson, that is to say, Canadian territory. It was thought that the British Empire could ultimately put about 8 million soldiers in the field, and these, plus possible orange troops, had to be kept out of this hemisphere. The key task of the Blue Navy was to effect the quick seizure and destruction of Halifax, Nova Scotia, the main northeastern Atlantic base for the Red Royal Navy. That was to be accomplished by three divisions setting out from Boston. At the same time, Blue Naval forces would launch coordinated attacks on the island possessions of the Red Empire. Targets of first priority were Jamaica, the Bahamas, and Bermuda. On a second priority list were Trinidad, Santa Lucia, and all the other islands of the Caribbean, the West Indies, and the Central American region held by the British. It was especially important to keep Red from seizing the Panama Canal. The possession of the canal was viewed as one of Red's paramount war aims. An interesting sidelight is the stress in the Red plan on seizing Honduras, British Honduras, what is today called Belize. The American planners thought that Belize would become a base for revolutionary groups and banded elements hostile to pro-American governments in the region, which foreshadows the role played today by Belize in drug trafficking and in support for the British-backed terrorist insurrection in the state of Chiapas in southern Mexico. At the outbreak of this conflict, it was assumed that the Royal Air Force would have air superiority and would bomb Buffalo, Detroit, and other cities. A blue force would gather in upstate New York for a quick thrust against Montreal and Quebec City. Blue forces would move west from Buffalo, east from Detroit, and north from the highly strategic Sault Ste. Marie Canal. Other blue columns would move against the Winnipeg rail junctions and against Vancouver and Prince Rupert, Pacific Coast ports and railheads that might be used by red and orange troops debarking. If orange joined the war, submarines and destroyers would prevent any major landings while the main battle fleet was massed in the Atlantic against red. As the blue fleet grew stronger, thanks to blue's dirigistic economic mobilization, the red fleet would be driven out of the eastern Atlantic. Finally, the red home islands would be blockaded and deliveries of food and raw materials cut off. With red facing certain strangulation, the U.S. planners felt that the red regime would be forced to capitulate, even without a blue invasion. If orange were still in the war at this time, then the main blue battle fleet would move to the Pacific to blockade orange into capitulation and bring the war to an end. Now, this plan was under active development from the early spring of 1921 until October 1936. It was worked on by General Douglas MacArthur when he was Army Chief of Staff. It was taken very seriously, since the British-Japanese combination was the only force capable of carrying war to American shores at short notice. War Plan Red was declassified in 1974, but most pro-British historians have attempted to cover up the fact that it ever existed. Now, it was a result of these British geopolitical machinations that the U.S. found itself at war with Japan in December of 1941. The British naturally insisted on a strategy of Germany first, meaning in their view that all troops and supplies would be steered to Britain, leaving virtually nothing for the Pacific. Germany first made sense, but nothing for the Pacific was, of course, a dangerous blunder. It is clear that Churchill and his circles were determined to make the war in the Pacific as bloody and destructive as possible for both the U.S. and Japan, so as to give the British a greater say in the post-war world and preserve the balance of power. Churchill had a number of ploys for doing this. The first was embodied by orders given by the London authority to the Australian military. These orders expressed a suicidal defeatism in regard to Australia. Remember that Australia is almost exactly the size of the continental United States. It's a pretty big country. First, the British kept the main Australian forces in the Middle East. Then, the British Colonel Blimps told the Australians that they could never hope to defend their whole country against Japan. They had to fall back to a line between Brisbane and Adelaide that you see on the map, meaning to hold only the southeast coast of this immense continent. When General MacArthur arrived on the scene, he immediately saw that an attempt to hold along the Brisbane line would mean that the Allies would be fighting in the immense spaces of Australia for years, perhaps literally forever. MacArthur convinced the Australians that their real line of defense was in eastern New Guinea, more than 1,000 miles north of the Brisbane line. MacArthur's thrust into Papua New Guinea led to bitter fighting along the Owen Stanley mountain range. It also led to the successful defense of Guadalcanal and to a Japanese reverse in the naval battle of the Coral Sea, which shattered the myth of Japanese invincibility in the Pacific. Churchill had expected that the U.S. would attack a succession of Japanese fortified islands and other strong points with frontal assaults, the so-called island-hopping approach leading to extravagant losses. MacArthur countered with the strategy he called leapfrogging, or hitting them where they ain't, meaning that U.S. forces avoided the strong points and cut them off, seizing lightly held islands to build air bases for supply interdiction. This method allowed MacArthur to go from Melbourne to Tokyo with only 90,000 casualties, fewer than the Battle of the Bulge or many other single engagements in the European theater. This success was also made possible by Australian Prime Minister John Curtin and his mobilization of the Australian economy, which made up for the shipments that Churchill was diverting to Europe. Churchill had been hoping for the war in the Pacific to last for as much as 15 years, until as late as 1955, with millions upon millions of U.S., Japanese, and Chinese dead. Churchill was checkmated, thanks to General MacArthur and to Roosevelt's support for MacArthur at crucial points. The United States was not bled white over 15 years in the Pacific. After the end of the Second World War, the British view was grim. It was that the balance of power in the Pacific had been totally shattered in favor of the United States. One response by London was to support Mao Zedong's communist insurrection against the pro-American Kuomintang government of Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek in China. FDR's personal representative in China, General Patrick J. Hurley, saw as a post-war goal a strong, unified China under Chiang Kai-shek and the KMT. The British backed Mao with the idea that the communists could become the warlords of Beijing and northern China, while the KMT might hang on in the south, below the Yangtze River. Stalin was going to be encouraged by the British to detach Manchuria, Mongolia, and Chinese Turkestan, sometimes known as Xinjiang. The British especially hated Chiang and the KMT, who were the heirs of Sun Yat-sen's opposition to colonialism and his support for modern economic development. The British by themselves would not have been able to consolidate Mao's regime. They were aided by the pro-British Harriman faction in the United States, including Dean Acheson and General George C. Marshall, who effectively made President Harry Truman their puppet in foreign affairs. The turning point came in 1945 and 1946, when Marshall was sent on a mission to China, which resulted in a half-year cutoff of U.S. military aid to Chiang Kai-shek at a critical turning point in the Chinese Civil War. After that, Mao made the long march to seize most of China by the end of 1949. The British were among the first to recognize Mao's government and supply him with strategic goods through Hong Kong. After Mao's victory, the British oligarchs were looking for ways to cut the U.S. down to size in the Far East and restore the balance of power. The result was the Korean War. Korea had been divided north and south between the Soviets and the U.S., although by early 1950, both had gone home. Harriman's friend Acheson declared that the U.S. had no interest in South Korea. Then Kim Il-sung of North Korea attacked. Suddenly, Harriman and Acheson discovered that the fate of the free world depended on Korea, and they convinced Truman to fight. Truman ordered MacArthur to do the impossible, to save Korea with inferior forces. MacArthur's defense of Pusan and then the Incheon invasion defeated North Korea and stunned the British plotters. Their gambit had backfired, and U.S. supremacy was greater than ever. So the British turned once again to their favorite device, treachery. There was in those years a stable of triple agents based in London, especially in the Foreign Office. These included Kim Philby, the first secretary of the British Embassy in Washington. Then there was Guy Burgess, the second secretary at that same embassy. Donald McLean was the head of the American desk in Whitehall. Other associates of this group included Sir Anthony Blunt of Buckingham Palace and Lord Victor Rothschild of British intelligence. There was also Lester Pearson, the Canadian foreign minister. These men were triples. On the surface, they were British agents. Scratch deeper, and they were working for the KGB, which had recruited them at Cambridge in the 1930s. But at the deepest level, they were loyal to the British monarchy. It was British policy to stab the U.S. in the back so as to restore the balance of power. Having some triple agents around meant that the British could do this and get away with it with plausible deniability. If the spies should be blown, the British could claim that it had been the KGB all along. The Philby-Rothschild group of triple agents were decisive in the Korean War. Philby and McLean were able to send Moscow, Beijing, and Pyongyang all of MacArthur's orders from President Truman. These included the restrictions against carrying the war to China with bombing, blockade, or hot pursuit. When Mao was sure that MacArthur's hands would be tied, he committed massive Chinese forces to Korea in November of 1951. Philby and McLean obligingly saw to it that Mao got all of MacArthur's military dispatches, so the communists knew exactly where and when to strike. In the end, Harriman and the British were able to persuade Truman to fire MacArthur, the greatest patriot of his generation. Finally, there is Vietnam. After the assassination of South Vietnamese President Diem in 1963, the only really good U.S. option was to stay out of that war. But there was in those days in Saigon a British military advisor named Sir Robert Granger Kerr Thompson. Thompson had commanded the successful repression of a communist insurgent movement in Malaya during the 1950s. He was billed as the world's greatest expert in counterinsurgency. Robert McNamara's recent book and other sources proved that Thompson was the number one influence used to encourage Lyndon B. Johnson and the U.S. command to take the plunge into Vietnam once Kennedy was no longer around to veto this adventure. Thompson argued that the British had done it in Malaya and the U.S. could do it in Vietnam. There remained the question of exactly how 500,000 American soldiers could influence this war. Thompson argued that the Viet Cong guerrillas in the South were the main threat and that they had to be combated by counterinsurgency, meaning U.S. divisions in the Mekong Delta carrying out civic action, nation building, fighting corruption, providing good government, and depriving the Viet Cong of their political base. The South Vietnamese defense minister had a different plan. He saw the main threat in the infiltration of North Vietnamese regular army troops along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. To block this, he recommended the building of a fortified line westward from the Demilitarized Zone, or DMZ, into Laos to block the Ho Chi Minh Trail. A few U.S. divisions would suffice to prevent infiltration. If the North Vietnamese massed to attack this line, an amphibious landing in their rear by Marines would cut them off and destroy them. The South Vietnamese Army would then take responsibility for civic action and nation building, since it was, after all, their nation. Thompson condemned this plan and any step towards it, such as the Khe San battle, as a diversion. The fortified line would have meant no My Lai massacre and no burning of thatched roof villages by the Zippo lighters of terrified young American lieutenants. In the end, South Vietnam was defeated by a highly conventional cross-border invasion by 18 regular North Vietnamese divisions, very much on the old-fashioned model of the Korean War. The Viet Cong had proven to be the diversion. So Sir Robert Granger Kerr Thompson, a close friend of Henry Kissinger, had proven to be a prime architect of America's greatest military defeat. He did it deliberately in order to help restore the balance of power in the Far East. We hope that this review of British geopolitics in the Pacific region in the 20th century, with special attention for the Pacific, has been enlightening. Don't forget these facts the next time some loudmouth starts spouting nonsense about London being our oldest and staunchest ally. This UK-US special relationship has always been a fake. This has been the LaRouche Connection. My name is Webster Tarpley, and we look forward to seeing you next time.